No. Can I get everyone's attention, please, really fast? Okay, sweet. We're gonna get started. It's 5 past 5. Really fast, I have the attendance sheet. I'm just gonna go start here and then we could pass it down. I'm gonna be tracking participation again as well today. So please keep your name tags out and announce your name before you speak so I could get that. And then last thing, no one still has reached out to me regarding if they're a senior interested in marketing. So if you are interested in that career path, talk to me and we can talk about a potential scholarship opportunity. Right now we have a guest speaker. We have Marissa. Solly was very excited about this and he was kind of sad that he couldn't be here today. It's going to be recorded, but Solly said that it's probably going to be the best presentation of the entire semester. So please listen up. Yeah, yes.
So generous.
High praise for you. High praise for you.
Thank you.
Awesome. Cool. With that, I'll pass it off to Rachel.
Hi, everyone. My name is Rachel, and I'm so excited to introduce Marissa Nichols today. She is currently the Associate Acting Director at UC Berkeley. Just some of her accomplishments here, she provided $18 million for the development of the Cameron Institute and pioneered a new student athlete development model and the framework, the California Way. She graduated from University of Nevada, Las Vegas in 2008, majoring in human services counseling, minoring in family studies, all while achieving softball, All-American, and NCAA Woman of the Year finals. Her next year, she worked to complete her master's, followed by her PhD, and she moved into careers from counseling, where she was a school guidance counselor, and moved into academic and athletic counseling, consulting, then transitioned into personal development and performance consulting. Marissa also became the first athlete director of leadership at Boston University and was a part of the 2023 NACDA M4A Board of Directors. Aside from her amazing professional accomplishments, she is seen as a very humble and passionate individual. Marissa is very open and connects deeply with her students and has a desire to create something bigger than herself. Learning about her accomplishments have made me very excited to hear from what she has to say. So let's all give her a round of applause. Hi, everyone. How are you doing?
Good.
Oh, it's so great to be here. I feel really honored. I feel a little nervous after that high bar. I love high bars, so I'm excited to try to meet it. Just a quick show of hands. This is Kelsey Middleby. Yeah, so good to see so many of you in the class. Who here is interested in a career in sport? Amazing. Who thinks they might be interested in a career in college sport? Couple hands? Yeah, a lot less hands on that one. So we'll have to see kind of where you sit. Towards this, but I'm just really excited to share a little bit about my career and how I got to where I am today. And my goal is to leave you with a couple insights, something new to be thinking about for yourself, and just really add value to your process however I can, regardless if your career is in sport or otherwise. So this is a little bit of what we'll talk about. Sully asked me to make sure I hit on the number 3 and 4 as well. And we'll have some time for Q&A at the end. So if you could do me a favor as we go through this together, if you wouldn't mind just jotting down any new insights you have as you go, any new things you want to think about, any questions you have for me, so that we can make sure to cover them at the end. Awesome. All right, so a little bit on my journey. I started my journey in Southern California. Who here is from Southern California? A lot. Isn't Northern way better?
No.
No, okay. Maybe an unpopular opinion by me, but I love Northern California. Southern is free too. But I grew up in a Middle Eastern family. My family's Lebanese. They're pretty conservative. And I'll share why I'm sharing kind of parts of this in my story. Our family was really thinking about conventional success. Like, we were really pushed to achieve. I'm sure many of you can relate to that. Especially being where you are today. And so I learned about success through a frame of like conventional accomplishments and achievements, like being a first in All-American or having a great job, things like that. I love that my success definition has like evolved over time, which I'll share more about, but that's sort of my roots and how I learned about the world. And I quickly gravitated to sports. Anyone else played sports growing up? I'm sure most. Yes, and so softball was my sport of choice. I hit a few others, but I really gravitated towards softball. That went really well, and I earned a scholarship, as mentioned in the opening introduction, to play softball at UNLV. And I had some offers from other schools that were like better softball programs, if you will, Ohio State, programs that were really established already. But I was really drawn to this idea of putting something on the map, like helping make something better and being a part of building something bigger than myself. So I didn't have the words for that at the time, but I was really drawn to that. So I got to campus and my coach looks me in the eye and I was recruited to pitch. And she's like, oh yeah, you're probably gonna be like fourth string. It's not looking so good. So you better start working on a different position and thinking about another way you can contribute to the team. So I quickly transitioned into an outfielder and leadoff hitter. And it was hard to change my role, but I did my best to buy into the process, really work on my craft, had a lot of support. And my first year, I became an All-American athlete, which was the highest individual accolade you could have. But our team had a really successful year. What I learned from that was I had, this idea of what I was going to be and how it was going to look, and quickly had to learn how to shift my focus into a different image of what I could be and how that would go. So I played for the Team USA that summer, but then I had injury 3 years in a row, which is devastating. You go from the top of your game to all of a sudden not being a contributor on the field at all. So I have this kind of dual image. One is being ready to hit, trying to be intimidating, sure, but, and the other one is me just in regular clothes in the dugout. And I was figuring out kind of who I was, what kind of career I wanted. I started to do internships. I started to realize that my identity was so rooted in being a great athlete. I know many of our athletes can relate to that. Our identity was so focused on achieving as an athlete, and now I quickly had to learn who is Marissa beyond being a great athlete. So all of that to say, my experience in college was transformational, and I had coaches who really cared about who we were as people. And what I learned about that was, if we develop the human being, we can develop the performer. So I believe that better humans equal better performance in any domain of life. I also saw how I held myself back, and I didn't really have all the tools I needed to really take my potential to where it could go. Even though I had success, I just felt like I was in my head a lot. I didn't know how to overcome certain things, and so there was this yearning to figure out, how do we make this experience better for college athletes? So fast forward, I get my first job, I guess you could say, as a guidance counselor in grade 12. I ended up being in a car accident that kind of pushed me to figure out my next steps faster than I thought. I always thought, I want to get my Ph.D., and I thought I was going to be a sports psychologist. Then my alma mater calls and says, hey, we want you to come back and actually be the first person to build out a program for athletes. We called it a life skills program at the time, and do your doctorate here. We'll pay for it. Start this brand new position, start this program. So I had to really sit with myself, like, do I want to switch gears away from being a licensed psychologist to more student affairs, student development, higher ed? I did a lot of soul searching and talked to mentors. I went for it, and I totally fell in love with the work. So I thought I was going one way. This opportunity, fell in love with researching my doctorate, applying the research on what goes into having a great experience as a student, what goes into being a high performer, applying that to the UNLV's first program. And it was really just the start of an exciting career journey for me. So also during my time at UNLV, during my doctorate program, because I was at UNLV for a while, right? I had other things to figure out for myself. I did hiding in the closet in terms of my sexuality for 9 years. I had to reckon with that and come out finally and bring my full self to work and my full self together in any situation, which you might recall from my upbringing, that was hard to do with a very conservative family. And also, I wanted to learn how to speak in front of audiences. I'm not perfect at it, but I put myself in situations to speak in front of large groups. And there's a group called Toastmasters. Super nerdy, but it's awesome. You get to practice public speaking. Do you know?
Yeah, awesome.
I highly recommend it. You get to practice being in front of the group. And then I started to put myself in settings in front of big audiences. And I gave our commencement address, and I graduated from my PhD. And so all this is to say that success continued to transform for me and who I was and what that looked like. So then I moved across the country. Boston University, and I was the first person in that role as well. So a theme, right? First person in these new jobs. Boston University got a $1 million gift to build a program for student athletes. Anyone here from the East Coast? I love the East Coast. I miss it, even though this is such a special place. Boston was awesome. I packed 8 boxes. They were mostly books. Went on my own, started this new role, and built my second program for an athletic department. It was also there that I realized that we had a need in the field. And what I mean by that is I would go to our athletic director and I'd say, how do you know that I'm being effective in my building programs for student athletes? How do you know it's successful? And he said, oh, I'll just know. And I was like, well, that's not helpful. No, I don't know what that means. So I started to look into, like, how do we measure success of these programs for student athletes? How do we know it's actually effective? How do we know that we're really making an impact on their overall development? So I became a little bit more known for that reach of how to measure and evaluate programs for student athletes. And that led me 4.5 years ago to landing what I would consider a dream job here at UC Berkeley. Berkeley got a $13 million gift to start the Tamarack Institute for Student Athlete Development. I have so much gratitude for this experience and what it's meant. It has been such a big part of my development and journey. And I wanted to share a little bit more about what my roles and responsibilities are with respect to the Institute. By the way, funny story, this was on like the second day of the job, and my shirt was actually like coral colored, but they totally photoshopped it to blue because I didn't know you can't wear red here. But now look, I'm wearing maroon today, so I guess I haven't really learned my lesson, but anyway, it was a good learning lesson, a hard one, one of many. So the Institute has been I've heard from Soli, you've learned a little bit about the Cameron Institute, and I know some of you have experienced the Cameron Institute. I have a video of it to share, bring it to life a bit, but just to share what my roles and responsibilities are. My job is to set the vision and strategy for the Institute. Love that. I'm also in charge of building the infrastructure. So imagine being a startup coming to a place and only having an idea on paper. We had nothing, so we got to build what is program look like, design, how we deliver it, how we hire people, where are we located, what are our processes, how do we spend and use money, all those things were new. We have to demonstrate return on investment, which I really love, to show the donor that this is the impact of the program. I also, in my role, need to learn how to and work on being really effective with different stakeholders, so I have to be effective with coaches, donors, my team, student athletes, alumni, there's a lot of different stakeholders. I get to help raise money, so
So the institute needs about $50 million to be self-sustaining. Kind of like the rugby program has done such a great job over the years of raising so much money that it's endowed and it can operate off of the endowment. The institute needs to be able to do the same thing. So we're at about $18 million. We have to raise $50 million total. So I help in that process too. And then I get to contribute to our senior staff. And I'm one of a few women on that team. And then I think just to say, this has really given me a platform. My dream is to build something so special at Berkeley that it's transformative for our students here, and that every athletic department in the country should have something like this. There's no way we should allow other schools to go on without having this kind of support for our student athletes. The Institute is very much a continued work in progress. It has a really good base, but there's a big vision for where it can go, and I'm really grateful to be able to lead that. I want to share just a video, a promo video that the department made recently that just talks about the Institute to give you an understanding of our goals.
Cal Athletics Cameron Institute for Student Athlete Development aims to be a world-class model supporting the holistic development of student athletes and coaches across three pillars: career development, community engagement, and mental performance. The Cameron Institute's mission and outcomes are to ensure, one, Cal student athletes know their career interests and are prepared to land a golden opportunity after Cal. Two, student athletes positively impact Cal's diverse communities and have the tools and skills to continue to make a difference beyond Cal. And three, Cal student athletes and teams enhance their sports performance, team culture, well-being, leadership development, and overall life skills. Cal Athletics Cameron Institute ensures student athletes are positioned to perform to their full potential and thrive for a lifetime.
Because of the Cameron Institute, I learned about myself.
Because of the Cameron Institute, I landed my golden opportunity.
Because of the Cameron Institute, I became a champion.
Some of you were in there. I hope that wasn't okay. I should have given that disclaimer. Did you see the coral shirt, by the way?
Yeah.
All right, so what I want to do is get into our exercise, and hopefully this is going to add value to your process. So, has anybody read the book Good to Great? So this is a really awesome book by the author Jim Collins. He went around and researched what are the differentiating factors between companies that are good and companies that really get to great. It's an awesome read. Probably don't have a lot of time for spare reading, but jot it down for at some point. And there's a concept in the book that I wanted to bring to you called the hedgehog concept. So there's an old Greek parable about a fox and a hedgehog. And the fox knows a lot about a lot of things. It doesn't really go into depth or specialize. And then the hedgehog knows a lot about one big thing. He goes all in on that. And so the idea is, these companies that we're studying, the most successful companies follow the hedgehog concept. They do one big thing, which is these three concentric circles, and they went all in on it. And specifically, the best companies, they knew what they were the best in the world at. And that doesn't mean that you're like the number one sales company in the world, or you're the number one technology company. It more means like, what can we do that's really special and unique that we can be the very best at? It's like, say, a bakery in Boston who is like a mom and pop shop, and they're very good at a target audience, and they know they can be the very best at that bakery. They're not going to maybe beat out the top bakeries in the world, but they're going to be the very best at their particular niche. These best companies also knew what they were deeply passionate about, what moved them. The cause bigger than themselves. And then they use that to figure out how to make a profit or money. And so the economic engine is like, what is it that we're going to sell or focus on to actually bring this to life, to actually create a profit or money? So an example from the book was this paper company, paper company had spent so much time trying to distribute paper through paper mills. And they thought it was going fine, it was okay. But when they thought about what they could actually be better in, they realized they could be even better at consumer products. So they made a big change. They got rid of the paper mills. They went all in on the consumer products. They knew it would help a bigger cause, and they were able to drive substantial revenue to support their company. So let me give you my example. What can I be best in the world at? So the top item there. I think I can be a really good, I have a strategic mindset to what I do. I have a big vision for what's possible in college athletics. I'm good at building from scratch. So remember, three schools now with three programs. Am I the best program builder in the world? No way. But I can be really good when it comes to building from the bottom up with a measurement lens and in a way that influences college athletics. So I think I can be best in the world at bringing those strengths together to have a really unique niche in college athletics and building programs to support student athletes that have a measurement perspective. Does that make sense? So in the middle, what lights me up, what fuels my fire is creating better human beings, better humans, better performance, and student athletes thriving. That like really just fills my cup to be able to do work like that. And then the way I've been able to make a lifestyle out of it is I've found a traditional career path in college athletics. I've tried to maximize the salary that I can get at these roles. So I can really max that out. I'm not here today if not for donors, right? The Brian Cameron gave a $13 million gift. So I work closely with donors. The way I'm going to be able to do what I'm best at and what I love is also through philanthropy. I'm also working on creating a tool that I can scale to college athletics to help each school in the country identify how they're doing in terms of their student-athlete support, so that can bring in money. And I started doing some consulting. I'm working with Cincinnati right now to help them develop their program. So those are the ways I piece together the economic part to make this career possible. So that's my version of the hedgehog right now. It's always evolving. And I would love and be grateful if you'd be willing to try the same thing. And it doesn't have to be perfect. Your prompts are essentially writing down what you think you can be best at. Remember, it's not the number one in the world. It's your unique strengths and what you can do really, really well. What you're deeply passionate about, things that light you up, things that you think about at night. And then also how you can make money from that, how you can make a lifestyle, living. And I'm going to give you about 4 minutes. That's not a lot of time. Just to independently jot down some thoughts. It doesn't have to be perfect. Just use those prompts the best you can. And then we're going to share with a neighbor. So I'll let you do that now. I'll play a little music.
And I'll let you know when the time is up.
Thank you. Sorry, I lost the song I was trying to play. About 30 more seconds. Pause where you are and go ahead and turn to a neighbor and each take about 45 seconds or so to share your hedgehog.
Thank you. share how they think they got the sweet spot of the combination of the three things? There's no wrong answers. Also, your name tags are awesome, by the way. I saw that in the syllabus. All right, not all at once. Yes.
So I just share like all three things.
Yes, that'd be great. Thank you. Are you Ashton or?
Andrew.
Oh, you're okay.
But for the economic engine portion, I was thinking that like the drivers for me is secure. Also being able to help other people with their money to have enough, and also provide security. For my passion, I think I'm passionate about helping others overall, but I'm really interested in like drug discovery. Providing access to so for the part where it says what you can do with investing and all that, I might have like a pessimistic view, or I feel like I actually am not sure if I can be the best at anything, because a lot of people are really good, and so I think I have a lot to look up to. So currently right now, I don't feel like I have a strong sense in the area, but I'm like, I'm cool with that.
I appreciate your humility. Is there maybe one skill that you feel like is going well that you could develop more?
If
you had to
pick
something.
Maybe like just persistence.
Yes, so that persistence and resilience tied to distributing medicine worldwide in a way that helps people, which is love. That's a great start. Thank you for sharing. Also, some kudos. Anyone else willing to share? Yes. What was your name?
Arsman.
Say it one more time.
Arsman.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. For what I'm passionate about, I put making money by creating innovative ways to make the world a better place.
Just to make the world a better place?
Yes.
Nice.
For my economic engine, I put down personal goals. And what I'm good at, I put risk from investments / disability. And then I think I can do all the others.
Yeah. How did those come together in this point, really, in that middle of the concentric circle? Do you know what a career or job could look like in that, with those three pieces you just shared?
Looks like the entrepreneurship to create some sort of way to make athletes a better, like, have a more sustainable lifestyle. There's less upon very previous competitions in the world. So now we want to teach you to look at that, see what it's really like. That worry that's not there anymore. But I don't know. So, I don't know.
Yeah, that's an awesome combination. Thank you for sharing that. Really appreciate it. This is hard to do, right? It's hard to bring these things all together to make it happen in your career. But just think of it as one tool or frame you can use as you move through your experiences to say, how can I develop the career and life that I want, thinking about those three factors together. So when I think about, Sully asked me to just talk a little bit about being a woman in sport. It's not a secret that it's a more male-dominated field and industry. And I just wanted to give a little homage to some of my mentors and role models. They started as more role models and they've turned into true mentors. And I'm really grateful for the teachings of these individuals. And so Lonnie, the head coach for UNLV, she's at Florida State now. She saw my potential. She's the one that said, you can be an All-American, let's do it. Like, here's how to do it. Jessica Mendoza was a four-time All-American at Stanford, USA. She's incredible. I learned a lot from her. I saw myself in her. I didn't achieve the same sustained success that she did, but she was an image of someone I could be like and achieve to be like as an athlete. Nancy Lowe in the middle, she showed me what a career in college sport can look like. She's the one that said, try this PhD program. Let me show you what your career could look like. And she mentored me through that. Dr. Christina Navarro, I'll try not to get emotional, but she passed away in November at 39. She was 7 months pregnant. It's tragic. She's one of my best friends in the field, and she was such a trailblazer. She helped innovate student-athlete development, created programs. She was a scholar practitioner, so she did a lot of research and applied it to practice. And I admired what she was doing and started to learn from her, and soon enough became a mentee at first and then really good friend. Desiree, the last person on the screen, is a really well-known athletic director. She was more recently in Missouri, just took the job in Arizona. She's taught me about how to continue to climb in the industry if I want to be an athletic director, and she's become someone that I lean on for that guidance. So why I share that is we can change this out with male-identified mentors, women-identified, but thinking about some of the themes as a woman in sport, I had somebody that I could see myself as. I had people that could show me pathways and shine a light on what was possible for me. So as you think about your own careers, who are the people in your world that can help shine a light on what's possible for you? I also leaned on these women to teach me the ropes, like show me the dynamics of what it takes to succeed in a more male-dominated industry. And I learned that my style of being kind of like formal and like asking for meetings and really wanting to process things and strategize, it's a really good strength that I own, but also in our field, it doesn't always work like that. Some of the best transactions happen in a cigar lounge, I learned. You know, like there's informal settings where you have to insert yourself a little bit and be at the table and find ways to add value that felt a little uncomfortable to me, but knowing the rules of the game, even if you don't like the rules, like knowing the rules and being able to try to get in and add value, something I've had to learn, and these women helped teach me that. But also, owning it. These women, they stay true to who they are. They know their style. They're not afraid to show it. They can adapt and be flexible, but owning it. They know who they are, and they run with that. And so those are things and qualities I've admired in some of the women leaders that I've looked to. And then lastly, before we get into Q&A, I wanted to just grab this in sort of a career trajectory of college sport and how it works. So think about intercollegiate athletics and the athletic directors at the top. There's two sides of the house, right? There's the internal side of the house. That's the side I grew up in. The internal side is everything that impacts the student. Academics, DEI, compliance, student-athlete development, that's my field and area. Mental health and wellness, those are all really important units and staff that help impact the student. On the external side of the house, think of that more as like the business side of college sport. That's your marketing and communications, those billboards you see, highlighting games coming up. It's revenue generation coming in, so the philanthropy, the dollars raised, the money that UCLA is going to give to Cal for leading the Pac-12, all that revenue. It's the fan experience. I know going to a game was one of your assignments, so external side of the house focuses on how to make it a great game day. You work on the facilities and the projects to make the fields better, and Soli's role of sponsorship and corporate sponsors falls on the external side. So there's kind of two pathways to the athletic director chair. I'm on the internal side. As you work your way up, you oversee more areas under each bucket. So right now I'm student athlete development, but soon I'll be overseeing more of those areas. And then if I want to be an AD, that would be the next step. I go back and forth on that all the time. I can share more later if it's helpful. these are the two sides. And when we think about NIL, I know you talked to Lisa about NIL a little bit. It's not a topic that I feel like is a great strength of mine, but from what I understand, there's the NIL bucket where you make athletes can earn money for their name, image, and likeness with brands and companies. I know starting soon, EA Sports is going to feature our college football student athletes. They'll get a cut of some of that money. That's starting this week. It's student athletes who are maybe wearing Lululemon and they get paid to endorse Lululemon. It's similar to how non-student athletes can work to earn money. There's a second type of NIL that's more pay for play, where collectives have money and they sort of give out a pseudo salary to certain players to help keep and retain them at their school. Now, I don't want to use any moral judgments on these two areas. Let's just name that these are the types of NIL happening now, and it's going to keep evolving. Just this week, I think the NCAA can no longer ban recruits getting money to go into a school. So this is a lot in the works, but what I wanted to just hit on was our role to help on the internal side of college athletics. We have to support our students with this money. And I would say right now, athletics and the Cameron Institute are doing a little bit more of an indirect approach, and we need to do more of a direct approach. So the direct approach, which I think is going to happen, we now have a associate athletic director just doing NIL in the athletics department, so this is going to get better and better. But we need to be educating students on how to save their money, how to invest it, how to use it. We need to help them understand how to align with certain brands. If you're going into the health field, it might be great to align with a health sponsored company. Being able to figure out how to align yourself to certain brands. We need to show students how to position their money for public good. Maybe they give money back to Make-A-Wish Foundation. Maybe they start an incubator for up-and-coming students in the area that are underrepresented. And we need to do a better job. We have like hundreds of professionals in our network that are helping students with their careers. Maybe they can offer NIL opportunities. Maybe they can offer ways to think about their career through that lens. Right now, I'd say at Cal, we've been doing more of an indirect approach where we have student athletes when they come in for their career development, think about how does NIL relate to the jobs they want, or how does NIL go on a resume, or how does NIL help you in an interview setting and how you sell your skills. So we've been doing some of that. Our sport and performance psychologists, we call them mental performance consultants, they help our student athletes with a variety of topics. Life skills is one, how to manage yourself, maybe how to think about capitalizing on these NIL opportunities. And then campus partnerships. We have a few really awesome classes actually through the Haas Business School that student athletes can take to learn about their NIL possibilities. So I think we're headed towards a more direct approach of helping student athletes with this money coming in, which is a really good thing. So I'm looking forward to supporting the department with that. I'd like to close. Before I won't go into these closing principles now, let's just pause and take any questions or thoughts as we thought about the talk. What came up for you and what can I help answer or think about that?
You mentioned that you now both deliver your programs. I was wondering which one was the most challenging and why?
Oh, great question. They're all so different. UNLV had no funding to start it. Boston University had $1 million gift from a donor, and Berkeley had $13 million from a donor. Berkeley is the biggest platform powered by Power Four School. Boston University is private. They all had unique challenges. But I would say this one, because the scale is much bigger. We have, starting with just me, we have a team of 10 right now, so maybe 12, which is amazing. It's a hard fight sometimes with 30 sports, and everyone has such unique needs, and how to meet the needs and exceed the needs of so many different programs. But I do love it, and I'm grateful for the challenges and how I've grown through that. Thanks for asking that. Although, you're in them. Here. Owen?
Owen, hi. So you moved on to three different programs. How did you know you were ready to be one program to start?
Oh, such a good question. Well, one was forced ending my graduate assistant degree when I graduated. Boston, I wasn't ready to leave. I would try all the time. But things like Berkeley was such a special opportunity to get kind of a once in a lifetime gift and platform to do this that I just could not pass it up. So I would say the principles were, it's hard to know sometimes when to do this stuff because there's always more you could do. But if certain opportunities come up in your area that are really unique and being able to capitalize on them, that's a big sign. Knowing that the work is never fully done, there's always more to do. Sometimes you have to just leave a place to be better, and it's time to move. I think you'll know based on your aspirations and goals long term to really think about the whole thing here. So, right, thank you. Can we go to the one here and then?
My name is Cassie. My question is, obviously looking back at your career, is there anything you wish you'd done differently?
Oh, that's such a good question. Yeah, I guess personally, I've been really hard on myself. Like, I'm my own worst critic. And, like, taking more time to step back and be like, wow, like, this is really hard to do. And being proud of the progress, the small steps. Taking more time to really enjoy that versus like rushing through it and like it's not enough and really appreciating that. I promised a question over here and then.
Yeah, thanks so much for presenting. My name is Beck. One thing that I was wondering throughout is like how you mentioned how fundraising is dealing with money and a really big part of your job, talking about your goals for the Cameron Institute. Donations. I was wondering how you would approach talking to a donor and deciding between either giving money to the Cameron Institute or giving it to the NIL collective to support Ross construction or something like that.
That is such a big question. So if you can get to hear, it's like donors have so many, just to paraphrase, so many choices how to help them decide. Do they give to the Cameron Institute, NIL? Thankfully, our development team, they have a little harder job. They have to work on that more than me. I'm more of like, they put me in front of donors that are, they know are interested in student athlete development. But I think at the core of it, it's like, do we know our vision? Are you somebody that can sell it and deliver? And if you are, people are going to be interested, and if they have the means to give back, and really try to follow the donor. That's like the athletics fund approach, is like, follow their interests. Like, if they want to give to NIL because they know it's going to make our program better. We need to embrace that. And also, if they're interested in giving back to student athlete development, amazing. Let's put Marissa and her team in front of it too. So, kind of following the interests of that donor and not giving them like a menu. Oh, I love that there's so many questions. DJ, would you mind helping me make sure we get to everyone too?
We'll start here.
Okay, awesome. Thank you.
Oh, me? Okay. You mentioned like how you were choosing between two paths and the sports and colleges were going to be athletics and moving to researching. I was wondering what it really came down to the ends and you mentioned the three things in the hedgehog and what clicked for
instance. Yeah, such a great question. What clicked with that pathway, psychologist or student affairs? I think one, to be honest, the opportunity that presented itself was like, hey, come do your doctorate work here and start our program. It was really amazing. But two, there was a mentor in the program that said, I'll help show you the way. Nancy Lowe, the one in the middle. She was like, I can help you study the things you're interested in. I can help craft this for you to look what you want it to be. And I think that support and insight made me feel confident that I could go for it. I wasn't totally sure I wanted to give up life in psychology, but I found a way to incorporate that into my career by building in those psychologists in the institute. So I'm not a psychologist, but I found a way to still light that fire by hiring them into the institute and how it works.
coherent and hearing is wrong for something new. I've seen a lot of PhDs have masters and honestly, this grad school requirements for college athletics would be great for their classes.
You mean more than college athletics with your bachelor's? I'd say master's is a little more common. PhD is not needed, EdD is not needed, but I find it to be a helpful differentiator when you're going against other candidates. Sometimes I wish having your advanced degree was more valued in college athletics. But I also, it's more about what I learned through the process and how I can apply that to the business.
What do you think is the most important personality trait for building a program?
Oh, great. This is such a great question, everyone. I would say having a few, like, core principles that are staples in your program. So the first would be really knowing the North Star, like what is the need of Berkeley, which is different than Boston, which is different than UNLV, and like crafting everything around the needs and support for that program and the donor who really cares about career development a lot, so we focus on that as much as we can. So knowing the North Star and vision, setting a strategy that allows for like progressive growth, because you can't, you know, build it all at once, so phases. Three is having a way to evaluate success. Like our success is measured by where our students land after Cal, their starting salary. Not everyone likes to put in their starting salary on our survey, but we try. Is there performance being better? Is their mindset better? Are they getting out to the community? Do they have an area of interest that they can get back to? So really our metrics. And constant growth, always trying to get better. Learn how to evolve.
Spoke a little bit about like your time in college and injury, and just with your identity shift. I wanted to ask, like, what steps did you take during like that identity shift process to find a way to find yourself outside of college?
Thank you for that. Well, I started like I wasn't just an athlete, and so I was just obsessed with working on my craft as an athlete, so I started to go to like student groups and organizations, started like get internships. I did a lot of reflecting on who I was outside of being an athlete, and I learned how to kind of lead from the sidelines by reading a lot of books, thinking about how can I add value even if I'm not performing, whether it's like providing support, seeing things that your teammates don't and helping them with that. So I just tried to figure out like what can I do to add value if I'm not out there playing. You can always look more.
I think we're at time.
Oh yes.
Yeah. Let's give her a round of applause. Real quick, just a few administrative announcements. Please submit those two assignments by tonight on B courses. Next week, please bring your playbook notes. That's 8% of your grade. So please bring that. And then lastly, who has the attendance sheet? Has everyone signed it? Oh, okay, sweet. If you have it, sign over here. Thank you, everyone.
If you have other questions, I'll stick around and let's connect if you can. Thank you.
Is there any way you get access to your slides? Thank you so much. And I'm gonna reach out. I have to go, but I'm gonna reach out. You're amazing. Thank you so much. I don't know.
It'll be like the point like where you can go like
no
like one day and not have to
write down like your sponsor.
Because I told you like this, bro. I'll say,
what?
Don't even do that to me, bro. Rip it off. Rip it.
Oh,
this is Lulu.
Stop, bro.
This
stop.
Is Lulu.
It's just Lulu.
Not
even. And Lee, bro.
Leader's gone. We gotta go.
Oh, shoot. It's like sharing.
Nick, leader's gone.
Yep.
Let's go.
Oh, my.
Just quit now.
Yeah.
school generation of campus. And I know it's actually right now, but that is too large to label that label. So I put it again. Looking at two business schools, specifically if you will be not from the top, but also that has to be changed today. So it's really just this question.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you for your help.